Sometime last year, I made an observation that between Alone in the Dark, Darksiders, Dark Souls, Luigi's Mansion, Dark Moon, Darkest of Days, and Dark, video games are showing a bit of an obsession with keeping the lights turned off, like they brought a barfly home with them and sobered up too quick. But as Newton taught us, for every action there must be an equal and opposite reaction, as seen when the barfly compensates for their appearance by being amazingly good at table tennis. So we've seen the army of darkness lining up, but I've noticed a growing army of opposition, containing such luminaries, no pun intended, as Torch Light, Dead Light, Faster Than Light, Metro Last Light, and, Microsoft Flight Simulator. These ranks were recently bolstered by two new soldiers the same week, both of which I would like to take a look at for you now. Of course, it must be said that Light doesn't seem to have done a lot to make these games cheer the fuck up. So first of all, Daylight, a game characterized by a total absence of the thing it is named after, sort of like the McDonald's Healthy Choices menu. Daylight is a horror exploration smartphone inspection simulator that owes a certain amount to Slender and its 8 billion derivatives, as well as various other horror properties. In fact, if we started listing everything Daylight owes to, we'd certainly delay it long enough for the leg breakers to arrive. You are a young lady named Sarah, who is trapped in an abandoned hospital, which is also an abandoned asylum, which is also an abandoned prison, and has to find the way out, all the while collecting pieces of paper onto which every single dead person who used to work here recorded every slightest thought that crossed their banal fucking minds, but who never used their eloquence to send out an order for a few thousand more light bulbs. So in all, it couldn't be more haunted if Jason Voorhees' mum had used it as a venue for her steak and stab luncheons. But while Daylight is riding cliche like a dirty pony, it thankfully avoids the usual sodding twist where the main character turns out to have a history with a place that they forgot about. Oh sorry, I was thinking of Mario Golf. That doesn't happen in Mario Golf, but of course it fucking happens in Daylight. Your task in each stage is to find 6 pages whereupon an object spawns in location A, which is used to open the gate in location B to get to the next stage. The closer you are to opening the gate, the more chance there is of, quote, shadows showing up, which falls into the Silent Hill Shattered Memories trap of removing all fucking ambiguity over whether or not you're in danger. But while Daylight is from the saturated school of indie gaming that thinks all a horror game needs is the odd scary noise and 3 feet of visibility, I do recall at one point making a little involuntary blubbering noise with my mouth, so it at least had some effect, until I realised that the shadows can only harm you if you look at them, and whenever they're around, a very unsubtle gibbering noise plays, while an even less subtle tip flashes up saying, hey, you remember how the flares work, right? Just asking. So when either of those things happened, I learned to take a close interest in a nearby wall and basically got through the whole game unmolested. Didn't help with the shadows that just spawned directly in front of me going blur, but those are the cheapest of the cheap scares. Those are to horror what standing at the mic blowing raspberries is to stand-up comedy. And look, that whole twist where the main character has a secret history with the horror, that only works if they have a character, besides a disembodied voice occasionally going, is anybody there? Or squeaking like a rusty hinge. We need to have made some assumptions about them before you can start subverting our assumptions. All I had to go on is that I'm a squeaky lady in a haunted house. So I turn to my brain and ask, why are we in this haunted house? And my brain goes, well, presumably because we've got a secret history with the place. Brain! Fucking spoiler warning! In short, can't recommend. Maybe try Outlast instead. Now let's move on from a game ironically named after what it has very little of, to something a bit more literal, namely Child of Light. The main character's a child, that's a tick, and the game's so sickeningly twee it makes me want to retract my legs into my body and puke shoe leather onto its face, 2 ticks A+. You are a young princess who possibly died and woke up in a strange fantasy land that you must now save, never-ending story style, by restoring the sun and the moon and the stars, all the while fighting off evil and bad poetry. Child of Light follows my patented formula for instant critical acclaim on the indie circuit. Small child, platformer, big scary world, a theme related to coming of age or loss of innocence, and a soundtrack reminiscent of the outro song from the Incredible Hulk TV series. Take my opinion for what it's worth, because I am fully aware I am the opposite of the target audience on this one, but I found Child of Light very dull, ironically. It's yet another game that tries to reinvent the wheel and add real-time elements to turn-based battles, in this case shining a magic torch on either the enemies to slow them or yourself to heal, which really fucks with the pacing when I'm holding off selecting an attack from the menu to sit beaming myself blind. Now, you unlock the ability to fly very, very early, so fights are easy to avoid, but you have to level up somehow for the mandatory boss fights. Is it worse when a game batters me with a boring stick or puts the boring stick on the floor and leaves me to batter myself? Also, I see a flaming spider in the overworld wearing a flaming hat spewing the words I'm all about dat fire in flaming letters, so I equip all my fire defense and water attack and start combat, only to find that Earth Badger and Ice Dentist were hiding up his ass or something and I have to fight them too. So combat was a chore, but it wasn't what made the game excruciating enough that I couldn't continue. And again, this criticism may be even more subjective than usual, but frankly what truly killed it for me was that the poetry was so fucking awful. Every single line of dialogue is a rhyming couplet, which is a cute idea as gimmicks go, but several thousand couplets down the line you can practically taste the blood running from the writer's eyeballs, as in the most utterly tortured possible way, arranges the words of another sentence, do they? With absolutely no understanding of rhythm, they probably think iambic pentameter is some kind of handheld device for measuring sunspots, and I know it doesn't sound like a big problem, but constant little niggles mount up to big ones. You know when you're watching your granddad type and he's taking so fucking long you get more and more frustrated until you want to shoo him away and do it yourself? It was like that. Whatever the game's merits, I had to stop because otherwise I would have bitten my controller in half and yelled, you can't rhyme delicious with ravenous! Emphasis is on the wrong syllable! You fuck!